how many of you have been part of a miracle? Have you been part of a miracle? Yeah, many. Amen. You know, how many of you, if you haven't, would you like to be part of a miracle? And what I talk about is God using you to answer the prayer that someone has just prayed. God using you to be his conduit of his grace in someone else's life. That's what it's being used by God to be part of a miracle. And you know, we live in a lifetime, and maybe it's not just typical for this era that we're living in, but people have primarily two expectations from God. The first one is, what can God do for me? What can God do for me? I have needs. God, you give me things, and we look at God like a vending machine. The second one is, what can I do for God? Which sounds a little better. What can I do for God? But sometimes we're motivated by, if I do this for God, then he'll smile on me, and he'll bless me, and he'll give me things. And we can earn favor by God by doing things for God. And we know from the scriptures that there's nothing that we can do that will change God's infinite love for us. He loves us infinitely, and there's nothing that we can do for him that'll change that or make him love us more. So we have those two expectations. What can God do for me, and what can I do for God? But what if there was a third option? What if the third option was, what can God do through me? What can God do through me to bless those around me? What if God would use me as a conduit of his grace to those around me? This is, I believe, living a lifestyle of the miraculous. Living a lifestyle, seeing and being a part of miracles all the time. You know, as our mission team leaves this week, and I've been a part of short-term missions for many years, and we always have the expectation of God doing something miraculous. There's always an expectation of being used by God supernaturally in someone's life and in many people's lives as we go. We go to bless people. We go to proclaim the gospel. We go to see God meet felt needs of the people we're meeting with. That's the expectation of the mission trip, and it's great. It's good to have that expectation, but what if we had that expectation as individuals every day, through the mundane, through the normal routine of a daily life? What if we woke up with that expectation that God would use us in a supernatural way every day? And I believe we can believe that, we can live that, we can expect that in our lives. You know, we have an example in the book of Acts of two men that God used supernaturally in a routine way that they were going about their day. In Acts chapter 3, we read this miraculous encounter of Peter and John. And Peter and John were on their way to the temple to pray. And it was the prayer time, so they were on their way to the temple. And they encountered this man who was crippled from birth. And they encountered him. The early church at that time was just getting going. They were still getting to learn and to understand how it is to be the body of Christ, to be the church. And they were primarily centered around Jerusalem. They were gathering. These were good times. They were giving to each other. They were sharing their resources. And they were being blessed. The apostles were figuring out what it was like to lead the church. And many people were coming to know Jesus as the risen Lord. They were learning to live, though, as followers of Jesus. More than that, they were learning to live by the power of the Holy Spirit that they just received at Pentecost. They were activated. They were activated as followers of Jesus, filled with his Spirit. And that's what I want to look at today. I believe in this passage in Acts chapter 3, verse 1 to 10, there's four keys to activation. Activation in the ministry. Activation to be used by God. So let's look at Acts chapter 3, and we begin at verse 1. Acts chapter 3. Now Peter and John were going up to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. And a man lame from birth was being carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, that is called the Beautiful Gate, to ask alms of those entering the temple. Seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, he asked to receive alms. And Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." And he fixed his attention on them, expecting to receive something from them. But Peter said, "I have no silver and gold, but what I do have I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And he took him by the right hand and raised him up, and immediately his feet and ankles were made strong. And leaping up, he stood and began to walk, and entering the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God and recognized him as the one who sat at the beautiful gate of the temple asking for alms. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Amen. You know, as I mentioned earlier, this chapter and is the early parts of the early church, right in the beginning of the church. The Holy Spirit had just filled the believers. Peter had preached his sermon, his first sermon, and 3,000 people had come to know the Lord. And the church was alive. It was vibrant. Things were happening. Many people were selling their possessions and giving to those in need. It was an exciting time to be the church, and it was focused primarily in Jerusalem. And they were praying together on a daily basis and worshiping together. Acts chapter 2, verse 46 and 47, Luke records for us, "And day by day, attending the temple together and breaking bread in their homes, they received their food with glad and generous hearts, praising God and having favor with all people. And the Lord added to their number day by day those who were being saved." What an exciting time, what a fun time to be in Jerusalem, living in community, celebrating the risen Lord Jesus, breaking bread together, fellowshipping and worshiping together. You know, some people make the case for, well, the early church met in homes, so we shouldn't really be gathering in large groups and meeting in buildings like this. That's not what it's about. We need to be meeting in homes. No, if you read the text, they disciplined themselves to meeting in the temple. They worshiped together. They taught together in the temple, and they met in homes. There's a both and there. And it's important. They met in homes. They broke bread. Well, were they sharing communion together? Maybe. They were also eating together, having fellowship together, growing together. But they had the discipline of meeting for prayer, the discipline of meeting in the temple for teaching. They maintained these disciplines, the disciplines of prayer, giving to one another, teaching, fasting, and gathering as the church. And I believe that's the first key to activation, is discipline. Now, we hate that word. We despise that word, discipline, don't we? Because discipline, I mean, to despise something means to make it less than, to lower it in our estimation. And we don't like the word discipline. It means effort. It means getting out of my comfort zone. It means getting into a routine and doing things regularly. But you know, nothing of value is achieved without discipline. You think about it, in a few weeks' time, we're going to be watching the Olympics. No one's going to be there in person, and if it ever happens, but we're going to be seeing the Olympics, and all of those athletes have achieved the top of their sports because of discipline. They've spent many, many hours training and preparing. It's the same with the Christian walk. To be used by God, we need to be disciplined in our Christian walk. I'm talking about our Christian disciplines, our spiritual disciplines of daily reading God's word, of prayer, of giving, of fellowshipping together. Discipline leads to preparedness. Discipline allows us to be ready to be used by God. So it's a key. I believe it's a key to activation in the church, in the body of Christ. So Peter and John, they walked towards one of the gates on the outer courts of the temple, and they were about to walk right by this man that was begging. They probably wouldn't have seen him or stopped because there were many other people around, milling around. There probably were many other beggars asking for help. And this man calls out to them. He cries out and says, "Help me." And he's beginning to get their attention by his calling out. And you know, giving alms and helping the poor was valued in the Jewish and the Hebrew custom. So by him sitting at the entrance to the temple was a very wise strategic move to position himself where he knows people are going to be coming and going, that in their religion is to give to the poor. So he positioned himself there. And in verse 4, though, I believe we get the second key to activation. Peter directed his gaze at him, as did John, and said, "Look at us." Peter looks directly at this lame man. Any other translations, your translations may say, Peter fixed his gaze on him. He looked intently at him. He saw him. So often we walk by people and don't see them. He didn't glance at him. He looked directly, intently at him. There were probably many other people begging. There were many other people milling around, but Peter saw this one man. And I believe that today in our culture we have a pandemic, and that pandemic's not COVID, although it is. We have a pandemic of people needing to be seen. People are just desperate to be seen for who they are. They're not looking to be famous or to be on TV or to have everybody know their name. They just want to be noticed and seen. And so busy in our lifestyle, our world is so impersonal and so rushed that we just glance by people all the time. And I believe that this key to activation is to see people. I know it sounds simplistic, but it's taking the time to see people. And what I mean by that is to see them through the lens of the Holy Spirit. To see people as people who are created in the image of God. To see people as Jesus would see them. How often we don't see people. We just glance right by them. And we rush by them. One of the most dangerous prayers that you can pray is to say, "God, give me your heart for people." And I say it's dangerous because if you have God's heart for people, you'll be going from grief and remorse and pain, and you'll be mixed with overwhelming love for people. You will have love for people when you ask God to allow you to see them the way He sees them, created in His image. In 2010, Debbie and I were leading a mission trip, short-term mission team in Waikiki, in Oahu, in Hawaii, and we were on Waikiki Beach on the 3rd of July. They have a very large party on Waikiki Beach on the 3rd of July. They just use the 4th of July to recover. And there's 250,000 people, they estimated, there that night. And we took this team of teenagers to go and share the gospel in this crowd. And it was overwhelming. And so we gathered everybody together, and I said, "Ask God to give you His eyes to see the one person you're meant to speak to today." And so we sent the teams out in pairs and threes. Debbie and I stayed, and Joshua stayed together. Christy was only 8 at the time, but she was leading a team, probably, and encountering people and speaking to people. And Debbie and I stood there, and we looked out at this crowd of people and said, "Lord, who do you want us to speak to?" And there down the walkway on the side of the road, about 200 yards in front of us, was a man sitting on a bench. We could hardly see him because of the crowds, but we both felt, that's the one we need to speak to. So we approached the man tentatively and said, "Can we talk?" He said, "You're welcome. Come and sit down next to me." And then we explained what we were doing and how we would like to pray for him, and he began weeping. Here was a man in a crowd of 250,000 people, completely alone. People were walking by him all the time. And his story was not uncommon for people. He had been given to alcohol and drug abuse. He had lost his family. His wife and his children had disowned him. He'd lost everything he owned. And he was desperate. And so we were able to pray for him and encourage him. And at one time, he had followed the Lord and had given his life to the Lord. And we were able to lead him to rededicate his life to the Lord. And he promised us that that night he would call his wife and ask for her forgiveness. And it was so encouraging to see the one person that God had us speak to. The one person, because we were able to see him the way God sees him. Again, we were just the conduit. We weren't the special. We weren't anything special, but God used us to see him, to notice him. Getting back to Peter and the crippled man, Peter didn't have any money. As we read in the earlier chapters, Peter, the early church, they pooled all their resources. He didn't have anything to give this man. He was not in a position to help him financially, but this man's need wasn't financial. He was begging, but his need wasn't financial. Well, maybe his need was to be healed. No, he had a bigger need than that. He had a need that every human being who has ever been born has, and that is to be reconciled with God. That's to be made right with the Creator of the universe. And Peter saw that need in this man. Being in a right relationship with the Creator of the universe is the need that we all share. So Peter boldly acts and God performs a miracle. Peter was bold. He says in verse 6, "I have no silver and gold, but what I do have, I give to you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk." And through the power of the name of Jesus, this beggar is completely healed. His muscles and his sinews and his tendons begin to grow, and immediately he is restored. And Peter reaches out and lifts him up. Didn't that take faith and courage on the part of Peter? We think, well, yeah, that's Peter. He's, you know, the great apostle. He still had to reach out when the man's legs were shriveled and say, "Grab my hand and get up." And instantly God did a creative miracle, not just rebuilding his legs, because he's been lame since he was born, but creating muscles that weren't there. And he stood up. God is still in the business of miracles, but I also want to say God is still in the business of creative miracles. I've got many accounts that I can share with you of God doing something from nothing. He is a creative God, and he is still doing that today. So this formerly crippled man, he was so excited, he jumps up, he's walking and leaping and praising God, creating quite a stir. And notice, it wasn't Peter that healed the man. It was faith in Jesus Christ. It was the power of the name of Jesus. Peter was the conduit for the miracle, but Jesus was the healer. And I believe this is the third key to activation: believing in the name of Jesus. Believing in the power of the name of Jesus. We cannot perform a miracle, but Jesus can. He is able. We cannot save anyone. We cannot heal the brokenness that are in people. As much as we like to train and prepare to be counselors, we cannot perform the miracle of healing the broken. That's only accomplished eternally and powerfully in the name of Jesus. So it took boldness on the part of Peter, and we think, well, yeah, but that's Peter. He is bold. He's known to be not the shy one in the crowd. But it still took boldness, it still took courage. And like Peter, sometimes we're asked to be bold, to step out, to reach out a hand and say, "In the name of Jesus," to pray bold prayers. I remember a pastor a few years ago preaching a sermon that left an impression on me. He says, "Do you pray prayers that get God's attention?" Now we know theologically that doesn't make sense, because God hears every prayer we pray. What he was getting at is, do we pray bold prayers, or do we pray safe prayers? Do we pray truly believing in the power of the name of Jesus? You know what I mean by safe prayers? When we pray for something that God's already doing, we often pray, "God, be with them." He already is. He promised that. Or do we pray, "God, would you help this person if it's your will?" When you pray boldly, I believe if you've been led by the Holy Spirit, you are praying in His will. Jesus said in John 15, verse 7, if you abide in me, that's the key in my words, abide in you, ask whatever you wish, and it will be done for you. Now, the key there is abiding in Jesus. We have to be abiding in Him. We have to be walking in His will. And when you're led by the Holy Spirit, walking in the will of Jesus, abiding in Him, what you pray is the will of God because He's laid it on your heart to pray for them. Peter was walking by the Spirit, and when he saw this man, he knew it was God's will to heal him, and he prayed and he was healed. He was bold in his prayers. Sometimes, though, if we're really honest, we don't pray boldly because we don't believe God can do it. If we're really honest with ourselves, well, I don't want to pray boldly because what if God doesn't perform a miracle? Then I'm going to look silly. Pray boldly in the name of Jesus. Warren Wiersbe wrote, prayer is not an escape from responsibility. It's our response to God's ability. Prayer is our response to God's ability. He is all powerful. There's nothing that He cannot do. And lastly, I believe that the fourth key to activation, this is very practical. And this is where we all can get involved, is the fourth key to activation, I believe, is whatever's in your hand. Whatever's in your hand. Peter said to the lame man, verse 6, I have no silver, I have no gold, but what I have I give to you. The man had a need for food, he had a need for clothing. That's why he was begging. And many of us, God has put silver and gold in our hands. I would say we're walking around with gold coins in our pockets, but we have resources that God has put in our hands to help other people. Resources that can be used by God to be the miracle for somebody else. We have material possessions, we have skills, we have abilities, we have time to be able to help others. This is where being activated actually becomes fun. Where we say, God, I give you my life, I give you my all. We sing that song. Lord, I give you everything I own. That's what it is to become a follower of Jesus, is to say, everything that is mine is yours, Lord. It all came from you. All my skills, energies, possessions, it's all yours. God, use it for your glory. And so when you're driving down the road and you see someone broken down and God says, stop and help them, you stop and help them. Or when you're in the convenience store and the Lord says, pay for that person in front of you. You reach into your pocket and you pay for them. When God says, give some money to help this person, God says, give your car to this person, you do it because it's not yours. It's all His. Being activated to become that miracle that blesses someone else. I had a miracle experience some years back. It's quite humorous. I had just prayed a prayer like this, God, use me in some way today to help someone else. It's a simple prayer. And if you pray that prayer, God's going to take you up on that. And I literally had left home on my way to work, and I was about two blocks from the house, and drove around the corner, and there was a guy standing in his driveway, his car right next to him, the hood open, he had his jumper leads out, and he was holding them, staring at the road. And I just prayed, God, use me to help someone. So I drove right up to the front of his car and popped my hood, and I jumped out and I said, do you need help? Well, it turns out that he'd been waiting for a friend, but he was late for work, and the friend just wasn't showing up to help him. And he was standing there desperately waiting and asking someone to help him. And so I popped the hood, we got his car started, and we couldn't talk long. He was late for work, but was able to share that I just prayed that I could be a miracle for someone. And he says, well, I was praying that God would help me. It's as simple as that. Just saying yes. There's a challenge. Bruce Wilkinson wrote this book called The God Pocket, and we're going to show a video here in a few moments. But in that, he challenges people, and he started doing this many years ago. He says, I always have a God pocket where I put $20 in. And it's God's money. And so he may direct me to give it to someone, to help someone, to pay for something. But he always walks around with a God pocket. And so I want to show you this visit. But if you do something as simple as that, you'll be amazed how God uses you.
What if you could take something little out of your God pocket and deliver it to a person that when they took a hold of it, everything in their life took a radical shift and joy flooded their heart? Because just earlier that same day, they were in the middle of a crisis of one kind or another, praying to God and saying, God, please show me that you're there. Show me that you care. Show me that you really do love me, not just in theory, but in practice. And God hears that person's prayer. And God knows the heart in you that you want to be partnering with him to help other people. And through God's supernatural arrangement, he brings the two of you together. And at that moment, he nudges you a little and says, ah, this is one of the moments you've been born for, and you know it, and you realize, oh, this is when God invades time and space for me and for the other person, and you reach in your pocket and you pull out that little tool that's little but is almost too big to describe, and you take it out and you hand it to the other person, and at the moment they open it up and see what's inside and realize God sent you to them to answer their prayer, you've experienced the joy of the God pocket. I've taught this to many people now around the country, and everybody who's ever used the God pocket come back and says to me, wait till I tell you what happened when I did this at McDonald's. Just yesterday, I went to the Office Max office store, and on the way out, I saw a man for the first time since I've lived in his house digging in the garbage can for some food right where I lived. And I realized, oh my goodness, this is a God pocket moment. And before that whole conversation was over and before I walked away, that man's life was changed and so was mine. Because every God pocket is a miracle, distinct and unique, because it's made from God who brings this person and you together, and God's in the middle who brings you together, and all of heaven sings with joy.
So we have four keys to activation. Discipline, reading God's word, praying, fellowshipping together, being in community together, seeing people, really seeing people the way God sees them, praying boldly in the name of Jesus, praying courageously, and then being available with whatever's in your hand, whatever God has placed in your hand, whatever time you have, use that. This is what I believe is living the activated lifestyle. Living a lifestyle, it's living a missional lifestyle. Wherever you are, whatever you're doing, you don't have to stop your job and your career to do this. It's living that lifestyle. But what about the results? What about the results of living this lifestyle of being activated? Let's look at what Peter and John experienced. We read in chapter 3, continues, the people were gathering around and they were praising God. And there was a lot of excitement as this formerly lame man was jumping up and down. The crowd gathers, and Peter takes the opportunity, and he goes to Solomon's portico, which is, in fact, the same place that John tells us where Jesus used to teach. And so he goes to this. It's a long portico along the eastern side of the temple, and he begins teaching the crowd his second recorded sermon. And it's exciting. People are coming to know Jesus as the Messiah. But before the day is out, Peter and John are in jail. Well, that was a twist. That's not what they expected. Here, everything was going great, and they were seeing people saved, and they end up in jail. Sometimes when we do and we're activated, I'm going to give you rose-colored glasses. When sometimes we're doing things, it doesn't always work out the way we expected. God sometimes has a different twist, a different plan involved. Sometimes when we get involved in people's lives, it gets messy. Sometimes when we say yes to God, we get involved in things that overwhelm us. And that's the truth. Sometimes it's messy and we wonder what on earth we're doing. But look what happened. Right after they put in jail, Acts chapter 4, verse 4, but many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. The church grew exponentially because of one miracle that had taken place. You see, we don't always see the fruit that's happening around us. Sometimes we see the messiness and we see the discomfort and the struggle that we're going through, and we don't see the fruit that God is doing. God's word never returns void. Isaiah 55:11 is a promise of that. The bottom of the line to everything, it's all about God's glory. If we're praying to be activated, we think, well, if I follow these four keys to activation, I'm going to be used by God. Well, then is it about us or is it about Him? It's all about His glory. You know, Peter and John didn't go around seeing people delivered and set free and healed so they could get their names on the billboards and so they could be known on the TV stations. No, they did it for the glory of God. They did it primarily and only for the name of Jesus. They were activated by the Holy Spirit to give glory to God. And we need to remember that. Every time we say, God, use me so that I can step out of the way that you get the glory. In a few moments after our table discussion, I'm going to invite those who are involved in the kids' camp and those who are going on the mission trip to come forward for prayer. We have volunteers, many volunteers for the kids' camp, and they need to be activated. They need to be prayed for and encouraged. And I want you to be a part of that in praying for them. But they need to be activated so that Jesus is known, so that God's name is glorified in everything we do and we say. But before we do that, I want to invite you to give your yes today, to be activated, to be able to be used by God. A very simple thing in your lifestyle, in your day-to-day walk with the Lord, to be used by God. I'm going to invite you to give your yes. So let's pray together. If you close your eyes, just bow your heads with me. If God's been speaking to you today about being used by Him and so that He gets the glory, and you see, well, I've got something in my hand that I can use for His name. I've got the ability to see people by the power of the Holy Spirit. I've got the ability to pray boldly. If that's you today and you want to just give your yes, simply just stand with me. I encourage you, I invite you to stand as we close in prayer, but just give your yes to the Lord. Lord, we thank you. Thank you that you use ordinary people in ordinary lives to do extraordinary things. We thank you, Lord, for those that have stood today just to give their yes, and you see that, Lord. You see the yes in our hearts. And Lord, I pray that you would use them, even today, in extraordinary ways for your kingdom and for your glory. Lord, I pray that tomorrow morning you'll remind them of their yes, and you'll remind them the next day of their yes. And Lord, that we would have stories of how you are using this yes, this activation for your kingdom, for your glory. Lord, that we would share in miracle stories, we'd share in stories of what you are doing in our lives and in the lives of our communities around us. Lord, I pray that we would have a kingdom impact in our communities, in our families, in our workplaces. Just in the simple things that we do that become miracle stories for those around us. Lord, we pray that the gospel message would be proclaimed and that many people will be saved as we give our yes. And we pray this in Jesus' name.